Hi everyone, my name is Kate and this is my husband James, and we are so glad that you've tuned in for today's service. We hope that you really enjoy it.
You know, if this is your first time watching with us, there's going to be details on the bottom of the screen and also in the description here on YouTube that you can get connected with us. We'd love to hear from you, find out your story, and really connect with you. So we really hope you enjoy this service and that God really blesses you.
My story, I'll testify by Jesus Christ for me. our hands to heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, we come to you. We come into your presence, God. We invite you today, God. Lord, as we take our eyes off ourselves, God, may you fill us, God. Lord, draw near to us today, God. Come, why don't you invite the presence of God? Wherever you are, come on, just sing your song to Jesus. Trading your crown for a cause, and willingly
this. Let's go.
Cause you take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Sing it up. Cause you take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good.
See a victory. You're gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. Because 2,000 years ago, our God came here on earth, defeated death, defeated sin. He has won it all, and He's still winning today. And that means that you're on the winning side. I don't know what you're going through, but you're on the winning side. You may be lost right now, but you're on the winning side. The odds may be against you, but you're on the winning side. You may be stuck right now, but you're on the winning side. Because if our God is for us, who can be against us? Amen. Man, we need this truth right now, because the situation that we're in, it's not easy. There's so many things happening in the world right now, and we need to declare this in our lives, in this nation, and in this world. There's so much violence, injustice. There's some questionable things that are happening in our nation. And here's what I know: we need God to move. We need God to move. That's our common denominator. And I don't know about you, but I'm a bit frustrated, and I think it's normal. Because there are some things that are beyond our control. So if that's you and you need God to move in your life, we want to pray with you. We want to pray for you. If there's something in your family, in your finances, in your business, in your mental health, we want to pray for you. Because here's what we know: in the middle of your pain, in the middle of your frustration, in the middle of your struggle, that the battle is not yours, the battle is the Lord's. So we're going to pray, then we're going to sing that again. God, come on, why don't you lift your hands to heaven right now? If you're with someone, why don't you hold the hand? Let's pray. God, we thank you, Jesus, that you're going to provide, you're going to protect, you're going to come through in whatever people's going through, God. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that many things might change. Our feelings might change. The government might change. Our situation might change. But my God, you never change. You're still good. You're still giving us hope. You're still giving us joy. You're still providing, still healing, still moving, God. You're the God of the turnaround, God, and you're turning things around. Come on, if you believe that, why don't you sing this again? You take.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it.
Yesterday, he's good today, and he's still gonna be good tomorrow. Amen. Hey, it was so nice to have you watching today in church. Welcome. We're so glad that you tuned in. If we haven't met yet, My name is Paul. It might be your first time seeing me on camera. But we're so, so glad that you tuned in today. It's my first time speaking to church without my neighbor's rooster, Cockadoodle, doing on the background, and I'm so, so happy. It's going to be an amazing day in church, and now we're going to give. There are many ways that you can give. You can give through direct transfer, through BDO, Union Bank, GCash, PayMaya, PayPal, but whichever way that you're going to give, I want to pray for you. Lord, thank you, God, for every person that's going to give today. Bless them as they give, God. We just declare, Lord, that every peso, God, be multiplied. Use it, God, to reach more people and reach more lives. We declare this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Well, it's going to be an amazing day in church. If it's your first time tuning in, we want to welcome you. And we want to say thanks for tuning in. And because you're not just an account, you're not just a name. You're a person, and there's something that's going on in your life, and you have a story to tell, and we want to connect with you. So you can press that button on Facebook. If you're on YouTube, you can go to the description and click that link. If you're on our website, there's a button that's going to pop up. You can press that, or you can just comment it. Just let us know, because we want to connect with you. In fact, we have a digital gift bag that we want to give to you. And if you're in Metro Manila, we want to give you a New People pack straight to your house with some amazing merchandise. But just to say thank you for tuning in, because we love you and we appreciate you, and you're a person that we value. Amen. Amen. In a moment, Pastor James will come up and preach a great, great word. But before he does that, why don't we check out this week's edition of Favor News?
Hey Favor Fam, welcome to another edition of Favor News. I hope you're all having an amazing Sunday, because we've got a lot of exciting things happening in the life of our church. So why don't we get started? As we move into this next phase of quarantine, we are going to be changing our service times so that we can add a live pre and post show before and after each service. This is to bring back more of the interaction that we love and miss from our Sunday services. So, starting next Sunday, we are going to be streaming at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m., 5 p.m. and 7 p.m., and 12 midnight. So, you can catch us on Facebook, Kumu, YouTube, and our very own live.favor.church. Speaking of, have you checked out our brand new online home? Come on over to live.favor.church. There you'll be able to chat with the Favor fam, request for a live prayer, see sermon notes and worship set lists, and use the integrated Bible app and many more features just to make church online feel more like home. We are officially launching our young adults ministry, Favor Movement. We will be having young adult services once a month, and the first one will be happening this coming Saturday, June 13 at 6 p.m. So for more info and updates, follow us on Instagram and Facebook at favor.movement.
If you're a young adult, this is for you. Maybe you're studying in college, you're preparing to do something, or you just started working. One thing's for sure, you're in a crucial transition, and at some point, you may have been lost, isolated, or insecure. We're going to do something about it, so you could walk in your purpose, thrive in community, and embrace your identity. Let's do this together. Join us as we launch.
Let's put the name here.
To my 1 million subscribers, this is it. We'll be launching...
Bro, ano name?
A few moments later...
So hot naman here, like me.
Wait guys, Favor Movement.
Join us as we launch Favor Movement.
This This season is the best time to deepen our knowledge and understanding of the Bible. We are opening up our free equipping series to everyone in our church. We are going through a Bruce Wilkinson's Survey of the Bible, where we'll get to understand more about the Bible, its context and history, and it's the perfect study if you want to learn more and grow in your faith. And the best part is, we get to do it all together. If you missed the first class, don't worry. We have a makeup session happening at 7:15 p.m. right before our class this Thursday. We'll be continuing on Zoom from 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. for week 2 of our 8-week series. So visit favor.church/equipping series or scan the QR code popping up on your screens right now. Get your hands on the hottest item this season, Favor Church face masks. Perfect merch for imperfect people. There are two types of face masks to choose from, available now on Shopee. So visit us on shopee.ph/favormerch or scan the QR code on your screen right now.
So we are here at one of the many evacuation centers here at Barangay Dushan Hills. As many of you know, they had a recent fire 7 months ago, but still they're being housed here.
Maraming salamat po sa mga tulong, kahit po ganito talaga yan. Marami pong tumutulong kagaya po. Salamat po.
As a family, we love to celebrate milestones. So we'd like to congratulate and celebrate with Hack and Juno Cordero for the birth of their daughter Solana. Congrats, guys! Aside from this service, we also have weekly services for kids, high school students, and a service with Filipino Sign Language interpretation. So if you want to know where and when you can catch all of these, visit us at favor.church/schedule for all of the details. If you want to know more about our church, join a connect group, or find out about everything we're doing in this season, just log on to favor.church/next or visit any of our social media channels. And that is it for Favor News.
Hey, welcome to Favor Church Online. I'm so glad that you are watching with us today. My name's James, and I'm just really excited about what you just saw in our news, that we are trialing a new service time next week and having a pre- and post-show live show going on. It's going to be so much fun, so make sure that you tune in on our online platform for that pre- and post-show, and also for on Kumu as well, because that's the only place you're going to be able to see it. And as well, I want to encourage you that if you missed last week, our first Survey of the Bible class, that you can actually catch up this week. The details will be on our social media, but you can have a catch-up class, which is right before our main session. My wife and I, we loved last week's session. We learned so much, and so I want to encourage you to sign up, get involved. It's free. You can invite anyone along with you, so please do that. You know, if you're just tuning in right now, my name's James, and today I want to preach from 1 John. So if you have your Bibles, I want you to open them. If you don't, you can look on the screen, because I'm going to be reading, and it's going to be on the screen. This is what it says in 1 John chapter 2, verse 3. We know that we have come to know him if we keep his commands. Whoever says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in that person. If anyone obeys his word, love for God is truly made complete in them. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did.
Dear friends, I'm not writing you a new commandment, but an old one, which you have had since the beginning. This old command, the message you have heard, yet I am writing you a new command. Its truth is seen in him and you. Because the darkness is passing and the true light is already shining. Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates a brother or sister is still in the darkness. Anyone who loves their brother and sister still lives in the light, and there is nothing in them to make them stumble. But anyone who hates a brother or a sister is in the darkness and walks around in the darkness. They do not know where they are going because the darkness has blinded them. You know, I want to get straight into it today. The title of my message is simply this: The Real Deal. The Real Deal. We're going to get straight into it. This is what John says. If you claim to be a real Christian, a real Christ follower, then simply this: you have to act like it. If you claim to be a follower of Jesus and to know him and to understand who he is, then John is saying you have to live like it. You got to be the real deal. Now, before all you crazy bedroom theologians start getting angry at me that I'm preaching some crazy theology that you have to do this in order to be a Christ follower, listen to me. There is nothing that you can do to attain the salvation of Jesus. It is a free gift of grace that was given to us because of his death and his resurrection. But this is what John is saying. If you've truly encountered that free gift, if you've truly encountered the grace of Jesus, then something should change in your behavior, because before you had no Christ inside of you, but now Jesus is inside of you. Now, here's the reality though. This change happens at different paces and different levels in every single person. Some people change instantly, overnight. That drug addict, that it gets instantly delivered. Then others, there's a time and a process. For some people, anger, jealousy, bitterness is gone straight away. For others, it's a journey that they go on. But here's the thing, it's not a destination, it's a journey. It's a journey of becoming like Christ that you're going to live every single day of your life until the day that you die. And so bringing it back to what John says here, this passage of scripture, this is what John is doing. He's calling out people that aren't walking what they talk. They talk, but they don't walk. He's calling out the fakers, the two-faced people, the claimers. And he's calling out people to simply be this. If I could put it in modern day language, he's saying this: you gotta be the real deal. You say that you love Jesus, you say you're a follower of Christ, then you have to live it out, and you've got to be the real deal, because you can tell if it's fake. Kate and I, my wife, we bought a vacuum cleaner. It was a very expensive vacuum cleaner about 4.5 years ago, and it worked really well for about 3.5 years, and then all of a sudden it broke down. We went to get it fixed because this expensive vacuum cleaner has warranty and all those nice things that you put on it. We tried to get it fixed 4 different times. Kate would go into another city within Metro Manila, fight the traffic, get a part, put it there, come home, and then we'd have to go back, pick it up. We couldn't get it couriered. 4 different times, every time we brought it back, it just kept breaking, even though it was real, even though we'd paid so much for it. Finally, Kate's like, I'm done. I said, okay, I'll buy a new vacuum cleaner. They'd given us this option that it's gonna cost this amount of money to get it fixed, and we'd already spent money. So I got online and I looked, and I found the exact same vacuum cleaner, except this time it was a fake version. It wasn't the real one. It looked exactly the same. It felt exactly the same. You could do it, except this time it was 10% of the cost. Not 10% off, 10% of the cost. I said, Kate, this is a great idea, right? This actually costs the exact same amount as what it would cost to fix. I can get this vacuum cleaner. I'm on Lazada. It's like the Filipino Amazon, and I'm looking at all the reviews, and people saying, oh, it's nice naman, okay naman. And I'm like, okay, well, this should be okay. So we got it vacuum cleaned. We pull it out. It looked good. It looked great. We turned it on. It sounded good. It sounded like a nice vacuum cleaner. I got it. I started moving it. It was amazing. There was all these crumbs on my floor because, you know, I have children. And so our lives are a constant mess because of three children. And so we start vacuuming and it sounded good. It looked great. It felt good. But the moment we tried to roll it over the crumbs, guess what happened? Nothing. Why? Because it was fake. It wasn't the real thing. It wasn't the real deal. It was fake. And even though it looked good, and even though it sounded good, it was fake. And John is calling out people that look good, that sound good, that even turn up to church and they say all the right things. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. However you go. He's calling them out and saying, you look good, you sound good, but there's something that's not right inside of you. There's something that you're not doing. You're not living the way Christ has commanded us to live, and there's something wrong inside. You're not being the real deal. You know, if we could actually take the Bible, right? And if we could find out what actually matters, right? What actually defines us as a Christian? If we could take the whole Bible and just whittle it down to maybe a couple of sentences of what does it mean to be a Christ follower? How do I need to live in order that other people around would be able to see that I am a Christ follower? Well, let's try and find out if we can actually do that. You know, in verse 7 and 8, John, he tells us about this old and this new commandment. And this is significant because we can actually find out through him talking about this old and new commandment that he's giving, what behaviors we actually need to display in order to be Christ followers. And so what's he talking about when he says the old and the new commandment? Well, when he's talking about the old commandment, he's going all the way back to Leviticus chapter 19, where the 10 commandments are given. And Moses talks about one of the commandments was this, love your neighbor as yourself. So that's the old commandment. He said, you've had this old commandment since the beginning. He's talking to the Jews here. He's going, you've had this old commandment since, we've had it since the Old Testament. It's nothing new, but here is the new commandment as well. And this is the new commandment, and it's coming in Matthew 22, verse 35. Jesus comes along, and he's having sort of a discussion. The religious leaders are trying to get him, and this is what Jesus does. He answers the religious leader in one of the greatest mic drop moments of eternity. We're going to read it here. It says, one of them, an expert in religious law, tried to trap him with this question. Teacher, which is the most important commandment in the law of Moses? And Jesus replied, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. A second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. You know, just before I said, if we could whittle down the Bible to a couple of statements to really just signify who we are as Christians, what does it mean to be a Christ follower? Here it is. Jesus tells us, if you want to whittle the whole Bible down to two statements, it's this, love God and love people. That's what it is. That's what Jesus commands us to do. And when it comes to loving people, Jesus doesn't put that on a lesser level of loving God. He says, love the Lord your God, and the second is equally as important. It's on the same level. It's right there with it. If you love God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and your strength, then you need to love people as well. And you know what I love about Jesus is that just like John was asking us to be the real deal, Jesus was. He didn't just talk about this, but he demonstrated this. And you know, John 13, it shows us how Christ demonstrated this love. After 3 years of walking with his disciples, preaching, teaching, hanging out with all of them, in the upper room, he proceeds to humble himself in a way that no teacher had ever done before, that no rabbi, that no king had ever done before. Maybe you know this story. In the Last Supper, he comes and he gets down on his hands and knees. He gets a basin of water and he begins to wash the feet of his disciples. They freak out. No, Peter's, no, don't wash my feet. I should wash yours. Jesus said, chill. I'm going to wash your feet. Jesus did what was made for a servant. Jesus became a servant in that moment to show love to his disciples. And we're not talking like, you know, you're all like, okay, wash feet. You know, we're not talking about our feet. You know, now that your feet, where you wear shoes or you've been at home in the quarantine, whatever it is, we're talking about washing the feet of men that had been wearing open air sandals and had been walking on dusty roads. So when you're talking about washing feet, it's not just like a nice, you know, this is cute. This is scrubbing. It's getting the dirt off. It's getting the mud off. In that moment, you know, it's unbelievable. In that moment, Jesus even chooses to wash the feet of Judas, who was going to become his betrayer. And yet he still humbled himself as a servant and out of love began to wash the feet. After this unforgettable object lesson that Jesus gives his disciples, he rams the point home by saying here in John 13, he says, "If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do just as I have done to you." You know, Jesus wasn't instituting this new religious practice that now the disciples had to wash everybody's feet wherever they go. It's now biblical. You got to wash the feet, wash the feet, wash the feet. No. He was saying something that was far more difficult than just washing someone else's feet. He was saying that if you want to follow Jesus, then we have to set aside our rights and serve one another out of love. That's what he's saying. You got to set aside your pride and serve one another out of love. Later on in that chapter, this is what Jesus says. I love what he says. He makes this statement in verse 34. "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you are also to love one another. By this, people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another." Does that sound familiar? Does that sound a new commandment? Now you can see the inspiration that John had when he penned this new commandment to live like Jesus. It's back here in these words. And so now, you know, guess what? It's not just John challenging you to actually be the real deal. It's now Jesus himself is challenging you, and he's challenging me is this. If you really follow me, if you really claim to be my disciple, then you need to love people the exact same way that I have loved people. How will you be known and be judged as being a Christian? It's simply this: if you love other people. That's how you're going to be judged. By our society, by people that are looking on. You say you're a Christian, awesome. How will you be judged? You'll be judged by your behavior and if you love people. That's what Jesus is saying there. And you know, this is beautiful and it's amazing that we talk about love and it's challenging, but sometimes we misunderstand what it actually means to love people, because we see the love that Jesus talks about, that John talks about. We look at this love through our own cultural filter. And a lot of times now, especially in 2020, with political correctness culture, you can't say, you know, things without offending people. What was fine 5 years ago is not fine now. All this different stuff. And love has almost become this. It's love is about being nice. And we almost have this filter of when Jesus says, love your neighbor, you know, as yourself, and the Old Testament commandment, then love is about being nice. And we think of Jesus, right? And I joke about this all the time, but so many times, especially when Jesus talks about love, we think of Jesus as, you know, nice Jesus with the lamb on his shoulder. You know that picture of Jesus, and he's kind of like looking up, or he's looking up, and it's this nice Jesus, so full of love, so full of grace. If you read the four Gospels in the Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you will see very, very quickly that Jesus does not match our cultural interpretation of what love is. In fact, you would accuse him of not being loving if you use our cultural, you got to be nice to people in order to love them filter. If you look at it, Jesus loved the Jewish religious leaders when he said to them, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, and you hypocrites. He loved them. He loved Peter when he looked at him and he said, get behind me, Satan. That doesn't sound very nice, but he loved Peter. He loved the multitude when he said to them, you unbelieving and perverse generation. Are you kidding me? If Jesus was alive, we'd be hashtagging. We would just be coming against him. We'd be getting angry. How dare you say that? How dare you put that? Jesus even loved, right? But he wasn't nice to all the people at the temple when he came in whipping people. Well, I don't know if he whipped people, but the Bible says that he got a whip together and he started whipping, throwing over tables, kicking out the money changers and the merchants, right? That's not very nice. Jesus is ruining people's places of business. It's not nice at all. But the crazy thing is that Jesus is love. Everything about him is love. Everything he does was full of love, which shows us that loving people doesn't always mean being nice to people. Now, again, calm down. Some of you are like, wow, this is great. Now I can be mean to people because Jesus was mean to people. So now I can be, whoa, mom and dad, you're a hypocrite, right? No, don't you dare say that. If you say that, I'm going to come and slap you in the face, right? With the love of Christ, like he did, right? You don't be that. Don't start getting angry. I want to challenge you with the same thought that I've challenged our church every single time. The same religious leaders that he called hypocrites, the same Peter that he called Satan, get behind me, the same multitudes that he called a perverse generation, and the same people that he kicked out of the temple, every time he did or said one of those things, he was saying it to a person that he knew he was going to get up on a cross and die for. So before you start getting all, yes, I can get angry because Jesus got angry. I can be upset because Jesus got upset. Love doesn't always look nice, but it always involves sacrifice. And Jesus didn't always look nice, but you know what Jesus was? He was a sacrifice. And he knew every person he talked to, every religious leader that he challenged, whether it was written in the scripture, and I'm sure there was much more that wasn't captured in the scripture. He knew he was going to be put on a cross and he was going to die for those very same people. So if you want to use the excuse of I'm just treating people the way Jesus did to be an excuse for your dysfunctional behavior or your mean behavior, can I encourage you, if you're going to do it, you better darn well make sure that you're going to die for those people as well. Because that's how Jesus lived. You know, when I discipline my children, and it happens often, all the time. My children are watching this right now. I love you. But they'll be the first. Every day I'm telling them off. Every day I'm making them accountable for the things that they do, which are outside of how we live as a family, how we've chosen in our family, the way we talk to one another, the way we listen and obey, and I tell them off. In that moment, my child would be the first person to say that I am not nice. I speak strongly to them. I let them know that I'm disappointed in what they just said. And that behavior is not a part of our family. That's not how the Aiton family acts. We'll go. I'm not very nice at all in that moment. They can accuse me of not being nice, but I will be the first person to tell you, my wife will back me up, is that every time I'm telling them off, I'm doing it because I love them. And even though it may not look like that, but for me, I'm looking at it going, I want to make sure that the way they just talk to that other person in a rude voice, I'm going to come and I'm going to bring it into line, because when they grow up, I want to make sure that they're respectful to people and they're a respectful part of society when they grow up. Now, as a child, and I remember this, as a child, I look back on my parents and I thought, you're not being nice to me. You're not being nice. But now I look back, and as a dad, and maybe some of you might have to wait until you're an actual parent. Maybe this revelation won't come until you father or mother your own seed on this earth, and they turn around and speak rudely to you or do something naughty, and you have to bring correction in, and then it'll be like, oh, my parents do actually love me. Some of them might have been a bit harder. They might have come from a different generation, but they did it because they actually loved you. When I'm calling out sin in a brother, like Jesus tells us to do in Luke chapter 17, when I'm calling out sin, it's not nice. That's not a nice conversation. Hey, bro, how you doing? You know what? The way you're treating that, that's super sinful. So, hey, let's pray together. That's not how it is. It's not nice. Hey, bro, how you doing that, man? That's sin. And a lot of times it can actually meet with, no, what do you mean? And we have these discussions. It's not nice, but why am I doing it? I'm not motivated by niceness. I'm motivated by the love of Christ that I see my brother in sin, and I want to be able to help him get out of that sin. So don't ever fall into the trap of thinking that love is being nice. And then don't go in the other way and fall in a trap and think, well, then I can just be mean and do whatever I want because really I love them. It's not that. You got to find that healthy Christ-like balance. Jesus challenges us, and John affirms the challenge. And it's simply this: be the real deal. That's what he says. Don't just say that you follow me. In fact, Jesus says your behavior is going to be an obvious reflection on whether you follow me or not. Your behavior and how you treat others and how you love others, it will be obvious whether you are a follower of Jesus or not. Love is so much deeper than just being nice. It's sacrificial. It's being sacrificial for a brother and a sister. Even if nothing is coming back in return, it's being sacrificial. You know, this week, the last really week and a half, my heart has broken for what's been going on in America, the United States. And I just want to be very open in saying that even though I have an American accent, I'm actually not American. I'm Australian and I'm white, which makes me the most unqualified person to talk about anything that is going on right now in America with the racism and the Black Lives Matter. Sorry, I am the most unqualified person to speak about anything of this. But the only thing I can say is this, is I know what evil looks like, and racism is evil. And my heart has broken as I've seen genuine people cry out for change, cry out for something that's been going on for hundreds of years, cry out for change to happen. That I've seen the Black people that are scared about what's going on, scared about their children growing up. I've seen even business owners scared about the looting and the rioting and all that stuff. And I've seen these people scared. And I hate evil, and God hates evil too. And you know, my heart has broken for it. Here in the Philippines, we don't experience racism on that same level that we have in America. Even though there are still, it's still a, you know, experienced race. I've experienced it in a minor thing being white here. I know other people have around. Racism is still here. But you know what we struggle with here in the Philippines a lot more? Something that we are right now in the middle of and have been in the middle of for a very, very long time is classism. If you don't know what classism is, let me, you know, share with you what it is. Just like racism judges a person not based on their character or their actions, but the color of their skin, classism judges a person not based on their character or their integrity, but the class that they have been labeled with. even within this in our country, certain people groups have been marginalized just because of where they live or what family they have been born into. And you know what? This happens both ways. It's not like it's just the poor that get classism. It happens both ways. Rich to poor to rich, middle to upper, upper to lower. This happens all over our society. And I want to challenge you today, if you're a part of our church, and even if you're not and you're watching, I want to challenge you here in the Philippines right now, just like I'm teaching my children not to see the color of someone's skin, but rather to see their character and who they are as a person. I want to challenge our church not to see the class that we have been labeled with, but to see the person, see who they are as a person, who their character is, who their integrity is, who they are, not what they've been labeled with, but who they are. Last week, I preached about breaking off the poverty spirit and the poverty mentality, breaking away from that. And I'm so passionate about people breaking out of that poverty mentality and even breaking out of the labels that you've grown up with, breaking out of the labels that even your parents have spoken over you. If you're poor and you've been put that label on you, can I tell you, you can break out of that label. And if you're a hard worker and if you're driven, it may be harder. And in fact, it will be harder for you than someone that was born into a richer family. But I believe with the power and the strength of God, you can do it. You can break out of the poverty mentality. I've seen it already happen many, many times within our church in the last 4.5 years. It's brought tears to my eyes. You can break out of it. And if you're rich, can I tell you, God doesn't care about your money, and neither do I. It doesn't matter. So don't walk around with an elitism of I am this upper class, I am who I am. In our church, and if you've been around, you've heard me say this, the moment that you come into our church, whatever class you've been labeled with outside stops the moment that you become a part of our church. There is only one class in our church, and that class is the child of God class. I don't care where you come from. I don't care what family you were born into. It doesn't matter at all. I will not judge you on what's in your bank account. I will not judge you on your English ability. I will not judge you on what clothes you're wearing. But do you know how I will judge you? I will judge you the same way John did, by how you love others. I don't care if you're rich or poor. I will judge you because the Bible, oh, don't judge me. No, if you read the Bible's clear. Don't judge people outside of the church. But within the church, Paul tells us, hey, if you're a Christian, if you're in the church, you should be living by a certain standard, and you will be judged within the church. And how am I going to judge? I'm not going to judge you by what you wear and how you speak. I'm going to judge you by how you love one another. How you love, why? Because that will determine if you're really a disciple of Christ. Oh, James, you're saying that you have to love then to be a Christian? That means that we have to do something to be a Christian. No, no, no. Go back to what I said right at the beginning. If you actually are a Christian, then love will begin to come out of you. Now, here's where it gets tricky. What if someone's hard to love? What if you're married to that person? What if they're your child? What if you work with them? What if it's your boss? You know, many of you have actually come into faith, and you've come from backgrounds where you didn't experience love, where your parents maybe abused you physically or emotionally or verbally. Maybe you've been a part of a series of abusive, you know, even relationships that you've had. You've had no models on how to actually love other people. You know, can I say this? Once you accept Christ in your life, it's actually urgent. It's an urgent thing for you to do, to search the Bible and to begin to learn from Jesus and learn from the Word of God how to love. it's urgent for you to get around mature Christians that are doing this, that again, no one has perfected this, but there are people that are further on the journey than you. Get around those people and say, hey, how do I love? Teach me how to love like Christ tells us to love. You will need to unlearn some of the ways that you've lived before, and you will need to learn new ways of living and new ways of loving. If you do not learn to love others, then you'll have anger and bitterness, and your relationship with Christ, it will suffer if you fail to learn and to grow in your love of others. You know, John says in verse 8, he says that this commandment, this truth is seen in him and in you, right? So this commandment of to love your neighbor as yourself, it's actually seen in Jesus and it's seen in you. And seeing it in Jesus is easy to see, of course. He left heaven to come down to this sin-filled, messed up world, to be born into a stable, right? To live the life as just a carpenter, not to come as a king, but humbled himself to be a servant. Jesus showed us that what love looks like. It's in him. To then die on the cross for your sins and for my sins. So in Jesus, we can say, wow, yeah, that's cool. Love is in him. But John doesn't just say it's in him. He says it's in you and in me. And that's crazy to think about. This love is in you and in me. And what does this mean? How is it possible that we're almost on the same level of Jesus here when it comes to this love? In fact, I would say we are on the same level of Jesus. Why? Because Paul talks and often describes our relationship as Christ as he is in us and we are in him, being in Christ. Romans 8, before you go crazy going, are you saying we're on the same level of Jesus? Well, no, let me refer to you to Romans chapter 8 where it says this, we are now joint heirs with Christ. That puts us on the same level of Christ, that we are joint heirs with him. And so the same love that is displayed in Jesus is now displayed in us. Why? Because of Christ in us. So how do you love someone that's hard to love when you feel like you got nothing? Well, maybe you could pray a prayer like this. I'm even gonna put it on a screen just to help you. You can take a photo and screenshot it, but the prayer is simply this: Lord, you know that I am empty and unable to love this person. Can we just stop and can we just say amen for being able to be real with God? Don't try to be all super holy, spiritual Christian that you're like, no, I love everyone and I'm, no, it's sometimes hard. So you start off by saying, Lord, I'm empty, I'm unable to love this person, but I am in you, and you do not lack love, even for the unlovely. Please love this person through me. It's a beautiful prayer that you can pray in order to help you in those moments where it's hard to love. Will it be easy? Absolutely not. It will be tough. It will be difficult. You know, even recently, I've been experiencing this, you know. One of my hesitations about doing online church, and we didn't have anything online or posted online, was the trolls that I knew that we were gonna get on online church. People just trolls and, you know, faceless trolls coming in saying stuff. And what's been happening is that we've been getting people getting on our services. Maybe it's you right now. And people have been, you know, saying things, you know, getting angry at our church because we wear hats in our church, and getting angry because women preach. And let me tell you, I have been finding, so I have had to stop myself. I'm just gonna be real and authentic for a moment, just because I know there's people out there that think the exact same way, and I want you to know, your pastor struggles with it too, and so you're not alone in this. I have contemplated many times creating a burner account so I could just get on church. And I mean, I've created backstories in my head of this person's name, you know, it like this huge, you know, I was gonna call him, you know, a John Evangelista. You know, that's a very just like, very Filipino kind of vague name. He was a backstory. I was gonna create a photo of him, give family photos so it looked real, comment on other things. And then I was gonna, and when we had a troll, I was gonna get online and say, you don't know that white preacher He's so good. He's the best white preacher. That church actually loves people. You don't know how dare you, you know, like I was going to get on. Last week we had a guy get on, right? And if you're this guy, I'm sorry, but I'm calling you out, right? We had a guy get on and start accusing our church of, oh, another man-centered message. This church is this, is that. Why don't you preach about the wretchedness of man? You need to preach the repentance. It's all about me, me, me. And I'm sitting there watching it, and I'm like, dude, do you listen to me preach? I'm not like a nice little pretty preacher that makes people feel better about themselves. I'm usually pointing people back. Just wait till the end of the sermon where I always give a repentance. And I was like, my fingers were ready to go, right? I was there. I was about to do. I was getting angry. And he's like, and the church name is Favor. Ha! Huh. All about what we can get from God. I was like, what? What do you mean what we can get from God? We get salvation from God. We get peace from God. One of the comments that was made was this, is that it's another me-centered message, that it's just all about being a better person. And I wanted to write back, what church do you go to where you don't become a better person once you've heard the word of God? What sermons are you listening to that you are a worse person after hearing about Jesus? And I'm there and I'm angry and I want to digitally punch somebody in the head. But I took a breath, and then one of our team members, Cindy, gets on there, and Cindy writes this beautiful message and says, hi, you know, I've been going to this church for a few years and I've only heard them preach the Bible. God bless you, we love you. And in that moment, I was like, you know, have you ever been really angry and then you're forced to calm down because you know you're wrong? You're like, you know what I'm saying? Right, serenity now, serenity now, right? Like you have that moment, right? That's what happened, and I was challenged in that moment. And I'm just being real with you, man. Like, and if you're that person that did that and you're watching again, I want you to know this. I'm annoyed at what you said. I'm annoyed because it's untrue, it's wrong, and it's not who we are. I'm annoyed. But I still love you. And I would still talk with you. And I would take the time to actually tell you that we are not a man-centered church, that the highest value we have in our church is that we're a presence-centered church. That when we worship, we take our eyes off ourselves and we put it on Jesus. And I'm so thankful that we worship a God that even in worship, as we give him our worship, we still receive stuff back from him. I'm so blessed that we have a God that loves us enough that he actually gives back to us and doesn't just make us just worship and hope that it gets to heaven. And man, when we talk about repentance, all. Oh, I would love to explain to you that I believe that we are all wretched sinners, saved only by the grace of God through what Jesus did on the cross, dying and rising again, that sin separates us from God. And it's only because of what Jesus did that we can actually come to the Father, not because of our good works, not because you've given money, not because of any of those things, but just because of what Jesus did. I'd love to sit with you and I'd love to share that with you. And I may never get that moment, or maybe this is that moment. Is that hard? Yeah, I'm annoyed. But John challenged me, and even more than John, Jesus challenged me. You really follow me? Then you're gonna love people. You're gonna love people. There's a lot of people that I can get annoyed at, and I'll share it with them. But in the same breath, I would die for them. And I would love them. You know, in a moment, we're gonna pray because I know there's so many people like me. In fact, I'd be shocked if you weren't like me. Where you found it hard to love some people, where you found that struggle to love people. But before we do that, I wanna give every person that's watching right now an opportunity that if you're one of those people that I just described that journey, if you're one of those people that actually don't have a relationship with Jesus, that are separated from God, or maybe you had a relationship once with God, but you walked away. something happened, you got hurt or offended and you walked away. I want to give you a chance to respond right now to Jesus, because at the moment, even though you may be a wretched sinner, Jesus loved you so much that 2,000 years ago, he died on the cross for you, that just in case, in this moment right now, as you watch this, just in case you decide to listen to my words and to accept the free gift of his grace, he died on that cross. And I want to give you that chance to respond. So if that's you, you're saying, yes, James, I want to pray this prayer. Now, I want to give my heart to Jesus, ask him to forgive me my sin that separates me from him. If that's you, I want you to put your hand on your heart right now. And I'm going to pray, and we're going to pray a prayer that simply reflects what Paul writes in Romans chapter 10. He says this, that if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. So we're just going to pray that prayer. I want you to repeat this prayer after me. You say, dear Lord Jesus, I come to you right now, and I confess my sin. I believe that you died on the cross, but you rose again. So right now, I ask you, please come into my life. Be my Lord, be my Savior, and be my best friend. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Can I encourage you that right now, if you just prayed that prayer, that is the single greatest decision you will ever make. And we want to know who you are, because the Christian walk is not meant to be done alone. Jesus did not leave his disciples one by one. He left them together as a family, walking together. And so whether you hit that I raise my hand box or you type it in our links, we'd love to connect with you and really help you understand that decision that you have made. You know, for the rest of us right now, I want to open it up and just have a moment where we just have a moment with God. Maybe we're struggling to love someone. You know, all over the world, there's so much hate right now. In America, like I said, there's so much stuff going on, race-related. Here in the Philippines, there's some stuff, there's people struggling with the terrorism bill and the government and just, you know, life in the Philippines right now. It's just everyone's on edge because of this whole quarantine. And has there ever been a time that it's been harder to love in the last 30 years? I don't know. That's affected the whole world. I don't know. But if you're like me and you struggle, can we just have a moment where we just let God come and just begin to do something inside of us? If that's you, could you just lift your hands right where you are? Right where you are, and I just wanna pray for you. I wanna pray, Lord, I pray for every person with their arms lifted, those that are struggling to love right now, those that are struggling to love even evil people right now, regardless of what they've done. God, I pray that as you are in us, even if we struggle, that you, through us, would begin to show love to each one of these people. If it's family members, God, give us grace to deal with them. If it's workmates, if it's our boss, if it's people, if it's government officials, people we don't even know, God, give us that grace to love like you love. The same people that even you struggled with, Jesus, you loved and you died for. Give that same sacrificial love and let that rise up inside of us right now in Jesus' name. Come on, I want us to worship right now in this moment. Sing it out right now. Change me.
Change me like only.
This world, come on, this world.
Jesus,
God, that's our prayer, that we would be more like Jesus. That we would be more like Jesus. To love the way that he loved, to care the way he would care. To be generous the way that he was generous. Make us more like Jesus. And in those days that we are struggling and in those days where we feel empty, I pray, Jesus, take over and love through me. Love through me. In your name I pray, amen. Amen. You know, I want to encourage you, if you're watching and you really, really, really struggled in that moment, and even now, you know, it's easy for me just to preach and then get off the camera. Okay, God bless you. Have a great day. But let's be real. There's some people that you didn't worship in that moment because you're angry. There's some people that you couldn't really, you couldn't say that because, dare I say, you don't want to be like Jesus right now. Because it's just easier if I can just hate or if I can be angry. Can I encourage you? Where you are right now is not your destination. You are on a journey. And so take the next step. If you're really struggling, say, Jesus, just help me today to love a little bit more. Jesus, help me today just to love a little bit more. Jesus, help me today to love a little bit more. If you know Christ and if you have a relationship with him, then he will help you and you won't be able to help but love a little bit more. People have different paces of the journey, but it will come. Reach out to Christ in this moment. Amen? Amen. You know, I really want to thank you for tuning in today. I'm so grateful that you're here and that you've been watching Favorite Church. You know, if this is your first time, again, I really want to encourage you, reach out to us, please. If you're in Metro Manila, we want to give you a free new people's welcome pack. We deliver it to your door just to say thank you for joining in today with our community. Remember, next week, we've got new service times. And we have our pre and post live show. It's going to be wild. Anything's going to happen before and after each service. Even our midnight service, we're having a pre-show and a post-show live. It's going to be really, really fun. And I want to encourage, again, our Bible survey. You can catch up this Tuesday night if you want. You can catch up to it. And we're going to do the second week. But if you miss the first week, you can come and be a part of it. Join a connect group. I know that the person's about to get on right now and do all that stuff, but I'm just saying, I want you to do all these things. I want to encourage, have a great week this week. Love someone, love someone, love someone. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey, thank you so much for joining us today. We hope that you enjoyed the service. If you raised your hand and prayed a salvation prayer, please let us know. You can do so by scanning the QR code that is appearing on your screen right now or visit us at favor.church/next. You can also text us at 0917-77-FAVOR because we want to tell you more about the decision you just made and help you through your faith journey as well. If you connect with us, someone from our team will reach out to you because we have a special gift that we want to hand to you. While you're here, go ahead and subscribe to our channel and turn on your notifications. If you want to see more of our content, then check us out right here and here. And that's it for today. We'll see you next week.